Yeah, so there's a question about historical data. So I'll give you an example of what a historical data will be. So for an instance, you're trying to predict this. Let me take another, the previous example that I just gave. I'm trying to see, predict a sales for Northern American, Bay region, which is on the West Coast. I'm trying to see that what would be the sales figure of my product for Q4, which will be ending this year. Now to predict that, I would obviously need some data sets of my past sales. So what I would do is I'll go back to my database or I'll go back to my business and I'll say that, give me a data from 2015, quarter one, quarter two, and quarter three. And you may also even go back to previous years. Maybe you can expand your horizon. You'll say for the last 5 years, I'm trying to get the data sets. So that is called historical data. So the data which's been already produced and processed and stored in your in your repositories. So historical data means the past data sets that you already have with you. So the historical data sets can be it cannot be only relational data sets databases. It can be in Excel. It can be certain emails that you have in the past, or certain documents that you have in the past. So that's the historical data we are talking about. Historical is the data from the past, and there is no limit that the historical data should be for certain time period. You can even see there are organizations which have data sets for last 2 decades, 20 to 30 years old, maybe from they do analytics based on beyond certain years. So historical data is the data which is coming from your past business, which has been already produced and processed. So you obviously don't do any writes on those data. So that data is baselined. There are no further edits being done on the data, and it's proven and it is from your live environment of a product. So that's the historical data. So that's which been processed and produced, and it is from the live markets that you have. So did I answer your question, Pranya?
Yes.
Sure. Thanks. So that's about the historical data. So you need to do a very thorough analysis on your historical or the data which is already produced and stored in your data warehouse, in your warehouse. And then once you have done your analytics or your analysis, there is no analytics yet. It is just an analysis of your historical data. Then you start producing the key performance indicators, the metrics that actually correlate for a business. So we will, as I said, you want to see what was your sales figure. So one of the key performance indicator would be, my gross revenue for a certain period, and then what was the gross revenue for that period based on the product that's been just launched or released to the market. So you start doing those operational reporting on such data sets. Once you are very comfortable on that, and you really, you have stabilized your operational reporting, or you have stabilized your understanding on the past data, then you start actually applying the statistical methods and models that help you to predict the future. So, as I said, maybe the future sales that you're looking at. So, once you know that your data has been once you know that your data, you understood your data very well, what are the different attributes of your data, and then you can start predicting your future. So we'll be looking at that in the next subsequent slides. But keep in mind, these are the three aspects: understand your past, understand, then you apply those understandings or analysis in the present data, and then you will be having the ability to predict the future. Keep in mind, again, the business analytics is not a stagnant process. It needs to continuously evolve. There could be certain scenarios where maybe you have applied certain logic, or based on your historical data, you just derived a model that helps you to predict your future sales. You can horribly go wrong, or you can terribly go wrong, because these days the data is not quite constant. We'll be again looking at in next slides how big data evolves. So Once you have designed a model that helps you to predict the future, a statistical model that helps you to predict a certain business use case, then you cannot assume that this model will or this algorithm will remain constant forever. I mean, because as it said in the slide, your past business performance may change, or may change in today. The past business performance that you have may change. There could be different reasons, like the client, the user preferences can change, the topographical regions preferences can change. There could be federal laws that can change. There could be regulations. There could be protocols that can change. Business is obviously quite fluidic. You cannot always assume that it will remain constant. So it needs to evolve, and obviously the customer data, because today a customer might be dealing with certain client base, and he may get into a new market. He can explore new horizons, and he can explore even he may launch a new profile of his product targeting certain group of customer clients. So even your customer data can change, and obviously the competition, because today if you see you're dealing with a certain set of competitors, and there could be a new entrant who might sweep away all the market in one go. So all these factors, they you need to keep an eye on it, and keep changing your models, keep testing your models. It's called training your models. So once you have decided a statistical model, you have to keep training your models. And when I said things can go wrong, obviously there are different examples. For instance, Google Analytics, when it was originally launched way back in 1990s, if I believe, or early 2000, when it has launched that, it was trying to predict epidemics for a given region in America, I guess. And then the way they have designed their algorithm was based on the historical data for that region, the diagnosis results of that region, and the patients that really were the patient age category, the patient's past history. So they were pretty thorough with the past data, and then they just went ahead and launched a public application in the public domain that can be used to predict an epidemic's breakdown. Now, what they didn't realize is that these models cannot remain constant. They need to be continuously evolved. So one of the attributes that were dependent on where the data, the data in the public domain. Now, the way a particular community reacts to an epidemic, they have designed that algorithm such a way that this reactions or these events can cause into an outbreak. Now, there was a scenario where, there was a breakdown in epidemics, and the public started reacting in a different way because they were trying to associate it with other diseases, or they were trying to associate it with different set of attributes or climatic conditions or geographical conditions. And this algorithm was never designed to handle such scenarios, and eventually it started giving terrible results, and it was giving wrong predictions, and they just went ahead and took it off for a while. So what learnings obviously everyone has from this experience is the models that you design has to continuously evolve, and they has to go through iteration evaluations. Each time you have to train your models and see how accurate, what is the percentage of accuracy it is giving you. Right, we spoke about business analysis for quite some time, and we also spoke about business analytics. The thing that wonders us is why now there is a shift. There has been a constant shift or a focus to make this shift very seamless and move towards insights into data based on business analytics. One of the key driving factors is obviously evolving data. So we talked about in previous slides that how your data changes. That you can, in today's world, you can never assume that your data set will remain constant, or the attributes of your data sets will remain stagnant for quite some time. There are instances where you don't even have a control on data sets. So that is actually the data drive. Data is actually driving this shift now very often, and it's also that now we have architectures and platforms available which can handle and process these data sets. Traditionally, we have limitations on relational databases or the Excels or the Word documents. You know, they have certain limitations. They cannot they cannot process beyond certain key characteristics of data. You know, they have been designed such a way that you cannot you need to actually honor certain rules. So one of the primary reasons is obviously the evolving data and the platforms and the technologies that now are available that can handle this data. So that is actually causing this shift towards business analytics. Now, if you want to see how a conventional data used to look like, I picked up an example from a production house, like Warner Brothers or Fox, any production houses. So what they do is, all these data sets are actually organized into certain structures or schemas, and then you put them into a table. Now, advantage here is you own the structure, you actually define the rule, you define the integrity constraints for it, you define all such rules and definitions for this data. And that gives you an advantage that you know your data very well. So, and you know that this data will remain constant, at least any new data set that is coming in has to honor these rules. So, for example, you will say that, I'm going to create these categories of movies: drama, action, comedy, suspense, thriller, animation. And then, so whichever data comes in, whichever new movie comes in, I'll put them under these categories only. And under these movie categories, I will say, I'll create a year. I'll say that what was the revenue that this movie collected? What was the remunerations that production house has spent on actors or actresses or any other technicians? So you are pretty well aware about what will be the characteristics of your data in advance. So it's called schema on write, because before you write the data into your database or into your repository, you are enforcing the schema. So you know the data very well. You know what would be the outcome of this data getting into your database. Now, once you know this, you can obviously write reports like, what was the best action movie in 1970s? What was the worst thriller movie? You can write any report, popular fiction or movie that collected the highest remunerations or, it got more Oscar nominations. Now, all this is possible. All this is possible because you know your data very well. And you know how well it is organized, and the schema, as I said, the schema on write. So it's very likely that those rules will be broken, because if any data set that is breaking this rule will not actually get into your data set, because you're enforcing a schema on write. So you're enforcing that at the time of inserting the data into your database. So all that would be pretty well organized into the way that into the way you have actually decided, and it very well. So that gives you a flexibility of writing those reports or stagnant reports. But that also comes with the limitations. The limitations is, now if you want to go ahead and actually do some more analysis and find out what was the why a movie failed. Now, if you want to find out why a particular movie failed in this year, now you don't have a data set, you don't have such kind of things available in your database, because you pretty much organized it such a way that you always had rules to say that this needs to get into certain data sets, certain databases under certain categories. Now I'm not denying that you may not be able to restrict this analysis, but this analysis will be only or maybe let's say if you want to predict an outcome of a sequel movie, for example, a movie that was launched in 2010 under a category called fiction. Now that the same production house is launching a similar movie in 2016 with another sequel, Now, when you're launching that movie in 2016, you want, now these days, these production houses are pretty tech savvy. They do a quick analysis of, how, what was the response of this movie in what was the response of the sequel in past years. Maybe users, maybe the lead characters were helping, the lead characters that you took in the past sequels were more popular, or the age group of a certain location was more liking all thriller movies or fiction movies that were launched around that same year. So there are different factors. I beg your pardon. So there are different factors that are helping to the success of the movie, but you don't have those data sets available in your database, because all you did is you created a database which says that I have a movie in 2010 under the category called fiction, and I'm just saying that it just collected a revenue of some X dollars or X rupees for this period. But beyond that, you don't have anything else to do an analysis and predict that what would be the outcome of the same sequel in 2016. So for that, you obviously need more data sets, like maybe tweets or Facebook comments on the movie, or from different social media feeds. So there are different other sources from where you can also find out what was the reaction. And based on that, you will establish a pattern that, you know, maybe the pattern was more critical about the script, or maybe more critical about a hero's performance or a lead character's performance, different things. I mean, you just have to establish those patterns. And then when you're starting a production of this movie in 2016, you would try to avoid that and say that, yes, maybe these things didn't work for that movie in 2010, or maybe these things really worked well for that movie. Let's continue in 2016 as well. So those type of analytics you may not be able to do if you have defined a structure and if you are enforcing a schema on right for your databases. So that's how the traditional databases, and it continues to be. There is no denying that even now. I mean, we just took an example of movie, but there are larger enterprises which do enterprise level businesses, like e-commerce based business, or any transactional businesses. They all still rely on these conventional relational databases, but with certain limitations. Again, you have to define a business use case for it. So yes, there is a data explosion now. On the right side of it, if you see, this is where I was talking that the database or data sets that we have more control and ownership on it, and we define the rules for such databases. But as we saw in our previous example, let's say if you want to establish an analysis or analytics on these data sets, you will have limitations, obviously, because your database is restricted to certain attributes and characteristics. Now you need data sets from different other sources. As we said, let's say from Facebook, you want to find out what was the response for that movie, or for the product that you launched, or how often it's been tweeted. You can also find out the moods of a user. Maybe someone would have said, yes, man, that product was great. I didn't like certain XYZ characteristics of a product. For instance, now, Apple is launching a new product, 7S, and there have been a constant debate in social media feed that they are trying to remove the audio jacks in next releases. So they're trying to assess that based on these feeds that is available. So all that is available in this space, and it's not available in your data sets. So this data is quite huge, and it's exploding, because everyone is free to write a feedback on your product, or everyone is free to review a product in public domain or in these social media feeds. So there is a very staggering growth of this data, and it is exploding. Just to give a glimpse of how this data is evolving, there are again various factors to it now, because with the advent of 3Gs and 4Gs, and you have mobile devices, you have devices which are faster RAMs which have capable of handling more data sets, and there are apps, there are applications like Twitter's, Facebook's, and WhatsApp. So yeah, there are different platforms available to produce this data, and it's really surprising to see over the past few years there has been a 90% growth. 90% of data has been already created. Now, this growth is not stagnant. It is growing at 40% compound annual rate, which is quite huge. So obviously, the source of this big data are different platforms, as I said, are available. And just to give you another glimpse of how a byte or what we've been dealing until now is maybe in the order of gigabytes, maybe a few hundred GBs or a few GBs of data that we have now. Today, the world is moving towards terabytes, petabytes, hexabytes, and then obviously zettabytes. So even terabytes are now breaching the limits. Now there are organizations like healthcare industries or the insurance sector. They have data to the tune of petabytes. So it just continues to evolve. So I'm just wondering what's beyond zettabyte. Nobody knows. But around 2020, they are seeing that most of this data will be reaching 40 zettabytes, in the order of 40 zettabytes. So to keep it very simple, there is a data explosion. The data is constantly evolving and growing. Now, let's also understand this term called big data, which is very often used in most of the analytics or most of the business analytics or any other domain that you're talking about. Now, we've been more used to data, which is already, like, for example, business analysis and analyst who works on Excels or Word documents or certain repositories, which is more, which is in the order of a few bytes. And then obviously some people also get the data from relational databases. So all this has been in the order of few GBs. Now, as I said, this data has been exploding and it's growing in the order of petabytes. We have already seen there are certain sectors in the industry which are reaching the limits of petabytes also, as in the healthcare, the insurance, and other financial markets. And social media obviously would have reached it long time back, but more organized sectors like insurance and healthcare, they are seeing a very constant spike in this data. So now you have to tame this data. This is growing quite huge. And also remember that we'll be talking this in the next few slides that a data which is huge and voluminous, it doesn't qualify to be a big data. So we'll see in the next slide, what actually qualifies it to be called as a big data. Now, volume is certainly one aspect of the volume is certainly one important aspect of your characteristics of a big data. But along with that, let's say now you have relational databases like Oracle, even the Microsoft Excel. They are capable of handling data which is in tunes of millions of rows. If I'm not wrong, I think Excel is capable of handling 1 million rows. Maybe I could be wrong, but it is capable. And there have been a constant improvements in relational databases vendors also. They're also able to handle large volumes of data. Now, where it gets tested is, obviously the volume, if it reaches beyond these limitations, then it cannot handle it. In addition to that, If this data is structured, unstructured, semi-structured. So when we were talking about data, we said you're getting data from a social networking website, or you're getting data from certain log files. So this data is actually unstructured or semi-structured, and you're actually joining this data sets with your data set, with your relational databases, or with your Excel to derive certain sort of analytics. So, and velocity is another characteristic. When I say velocity, data that is constantly getting generated at a constant rate. Now, we just spoke about the Twitter feeds. Once you have launched a product in the market and you're trying to see what is the reaction of certain groups or what is the reaction in the market. So there'll be people who will be constantly tweeting, retweeting, or talking about this product. So this is where the events are getting generated, and they are getting generated at a very constant rate. You do not have a control on limiting that speed or that rate. So the velocity is also one of the important characteristics of big data. And again, the similarly, it can be a structured, unstructured, or semi-structured data. And then the variety. Variety is because you have data you are getting the data from different sources, and all that can attribute to variety of the data that you're looking at. In a way, it's actually very important, I would say, for analytics. The variety is very important because the more varied data you have, the more solid analytics you can build. So I think, you know, once you get into more analytics, and you'll actually realize that, you know, it's not important that volume is not necessarily important. The more variety you have, the more you know, you will be able to derive the patterns, because with a limited set of data patterns, or with a limited set of variety, you may not be able to actually get all use cases. For example, we talked about the Google Analytics on predicting an epidemic breakdown. So they didn't really had a variety of data available at their disposal from their past historical data. So the more variety helps you to actually, you know, test different use cases, and makes your to solidify your model very well. So these are the characteristics. So always remember, volume, there is a general perception that, you know, big data is just voluminous. It is not. It is, you know, there is another example which I can quote from sports, where they try to predict you know, certain events. For example, soccer, when they see that you want to see how would be your sports, how would be your you know, certain players in like a midfielder or a defender, what are his moves, you can start predicting. So there you don't get a volume of data. What you do is, at every second, every nick of a second, you're seeing that what are his reflexes. So that's the constant rate at which the data is getting generated, and then you start streaming this data into your platform, and then you start doing an analysis on it. So this would be, you know, for a given 2 seconds of time frame, you would only hardly get maybe 10,000 or some few hundreds, in the order of few hundreds events where this particular player has moved in certain directions. So volume, again, it's not important. It is only, the problem is with the velocity. So today's applications that we write, they are all like batch oriented. They consume the data from your already ingested data sources. Like, you know, you already have ingested the data into your relational database, and then you start processing and then produce the final report or outcome of your business logic. So velocity is typically not possible to handle with conventional you know, approaches or applications or softwares. And variety, again, we spoke about how important it is for the analytics. To give another glimpse of what big data is, you know, the Walmart, I think most of us would be familiar, the retail US retail market chain. This company has 2 million customer transactions every hour, you know, around their globe, around different regions of America. So it's quite huge, and I'm not sure how such data can be really stored into relational databases. Even a Boeing plane that generates 20 terabyte of data for every hour of the flight that it translates into, or it just covers. So these are the data that we are now talking about. Again, to reemphasize, the data source is changing. You cannot just restrict yourself to a relational database or to an Excel that you already have. And then you can say that, no, you can start doing an analytics. So in order to actually gain the advantage of analytics, you start exploring the data or ingesting the data from different data sources. So that's where things have been changing. I mean, things have been really changing over past few years, and there is an emphasis on getting into analytics based on these data sources. Right, I think most of us have not heard the term called data lakes, but it's a new term. It's evolving, and there are organizations now in the market who are actively trying to build data lakes. So data warehouse traditionally has been there in the market for quite some time, and this is the warehouse where you actually, you know, pump all your data, or you know, push all your processed data, which is again organized and structured. But in data lakes, again, as we saw, you can actually put the data from any source. So for an instance, you can get the data from on a LinkedIn or on a Twitter, which can be unstructured or semi-structured, and then you can add it into your relational database. So data lake is a conglomeration of all data sets, and it's very loosely coupled. Processing, again, as I said, the data warehouses, they emphasize all the rules should be honored or should be applied at the time of writing the data. So the schema, that's what the rules are defined, where the rules are defined. Schema on write is emphasized, and schema on read. So here in the data lake, when you're reading the data, you would say that, okay, whether it really honors or adheres to certain rules. But again, this is optional. In some cases, you wouldn't have a schema. You may be just looking at some raw log files or some text files where you really don't want to apply any schema on it. So things are very fluidic there. Storage, there has been a traditional problem with the relational data warehouses. The problem is that it's very expensive to install those high-end database servers. And the limitation again is on their processing capabilities. When you want to improve those processing capabilities, you have to do a vertical improvement. In the sense, when you improve a server, what you do is you keep adding more cores to it or more CPU slots to it, which is a vertical growth. So on a single system, you're trying to add more more processing capabilities or to it. So and it's pretty expensive because all these high-end servers are really expensive and hard to procure. Whereas on data lakes, they are built on big data platforms. We will see in next few slides how big data handles this problem. It has a horizontal growth, and it can work on the hardwares which are not pretty expensive. So it's actually designed for low cost storage. Agility, yes, we have obviously, since we are saying everything is tied to schema on write, so it's less agile. It is actually restricted to fixed set of configurations, but data lake is highly agile. It can be fluidic. You don't sometimes, as I said, you don't really enforce any rules or restrictions on it. So it's quite agile. Security, I would actually vouch for data warehouse. It's very matured, and we have different restrictions in place. We know all these traditional databases have really evolved very well in handling the security. Data lakes is pretty new into the market, so I'm not. I have my own apprehensions about security on this side. And the last one is most important for this conversation. Users. Mostly people like business analysts and business analysis, they are the primary consumers of data warehouses. And data lakes, as I said, is more suitable for data scientists and business analytics folks who want to do more analytics on the data sets. So I'm sure any of your organizations, or you might hear that some of these terms very often, where data lakes have been built, are in the process of building a data lake. Now let's take a look back and see we had just talked about business analytics. We talked about the big data, and we also talked about different types and characteristics of a big data. Now, if you still want to continue applying the same methodologies of business analysis or business analyst, that kind of poses certain challenges. One of the key aspects of business analysis is to derive certain patterns, which remains the same and which doesn't change. But your role would be same. Let's say you would be still trying to find out certain key performance indicator or metric in a business, or you might be writing certain requirements, or you're trying to actually do a risk assessment of a certain market. So your role or your end goal still remains the same as a business analyst. But what actually changes is the data sets, and if you start, these things, and if you start applying those techniques on it, it sometimes falls flat. Now, let's say if you have conventional tools like Excel or relational database, and you have certain SQL queries or certain other techniques that you would be more familiar in deriving a report, and the frameworks, like, you know, a software which is already capable of handling relational data. So this will break even when you apply on big data, because it's maybe certain characteristics it may break even is on the volume side, or as we said about the variety or the velocity, maybe at a constant rate when you're generating a data. Maybe these tools are not capable or designed to handle such data, such characteristics of data. And most importantly, you cannot restrict yourself to a day-to-day operational reporting on a business, because market has been really changed over the past few years with the advent of all technologies, your social networking sites, and user preferences have changed. So things have really changed a lot in today's world. So a business cannot remain constant and stagnant with these approaches. So you need to adopt a shift towards it. So keep in mind that there's always these three characteristics are important. So we tend to kind of forget that, you know, when we see a raw data, a processed data, we sometimes forget that, you know, there are different attributes in a data apart from internal attributes, like, I mean, which is specific to a business. There are other attributes like volume, velocity and variety, which we spoke about. So these things are important to keep in mind when you're working on it. And there are frameworks, as I said, and then platform, which is now available, and the massive parallel processing. But as a business analytic guy, you may not be very keen on the lower level technology aspects or frameworks. But it's good if you understand, because that's how you tend to learn, or you know, when you're applying certain library, or when you're trying to use certain API or certain tool, it helps you, you know, to correlate things. So so just to reinforce again, it's important that you start as a business analyst and you understand all your business pretty well, and then you lead towards business analytics. So having an understanding of the business or the product framework will be an added advantage when you move into business analytics. So the only change that you see here is the data characteristics and the tools that we use and the frameworks. So yes, guys, it's always an advantage if you have analytical skills in today's market, because as I said, the industry is now actually realizing the importance of making decisions based on data insights. And that kind of really helped for many businesses in today's market. You know, there are businesses who are doing pretty well based on these analytical implementations they have done. And there are certain industries like healthcare and insurance where they use it for doing more thorough understanding of maybe, let's say, a patient profile or a user's credit history. So there are different use cases. I mean, we can keep talking about it, but if you have those analytical skills, it gives you an advantage. So always, again, I keep saying this because there are people who believe that, you know, business analytics is only on big data. It is not just limited to big data, because, you know, it's important if you see the actual definition. This is the actual definition of business analytics, as it says. I'll just read it out for the reference. It says business analytics is the practice of iterative methodical exploration of an organization's data with emphasis on statistics analysis. So if you see, it never states that an organization's data, which is a big data, because you need to be very familiar with statistics, and you have and those statistical models, how you can apply on data. There are data scientists which I know who don't even work on not more than 10,000 or few thousand of rows of data. So, but they are more familiar with statistics and the regression models, or different characteristics or attributes of a statistical framework. So all they do is, since they know this, they just apply and they try to find correlation between different data patterns. So how an input variable can be correlated to another input variable. So it's not important that you always have to work on big data. Maybe in certain organizations, you know, you will see that they could be big data engineers who will help to ingest the data into your into the platform, process it, and give you a finally processed data, maybe let's say for 1 or 2 years, or maybe for a few months. And then as a business analytical guy, you might apply all your you know, statistical skills or your experience on statistics to derive the business use cases out of it. So it can be, as I said, even on non-big data sets. For example, you want, there was a question in the earlier part of this presentation about historical data. So maybe, you know, I said that you will just pick up last few quarters from 2015 to see what was your sales figure. And in that case, you don't even have to go into a big data platform and process this data and then find out what is the final outcome out of it, apply your statistics. All you can do is you can go back to your Excel, or you can go back to your data warehouse and get those 3 quarters of data, which could be in a few thousand rows or a few hundred rows, and then you can apply your statistics on it. So it can be either way, but maybe let's say now you want to see what was your sales performance or your product sales in last 10 years, then yes, that would be a data set which would be quite huge, which can run into a few million rows. In that aspect, maybe you need to get the data into big data platform, process it, organize it, or you know, produce a certain KPIs out of it, and then you can start applying your statistics on it. So it's either ways, big data or non-big data, but important thing is you should have a statistical and analytical skills on it. Now, why, I mean, there is a lead towards this business analytics is all successful businesses, as I said, have taken advantage of this business analytics. They have gained improvements. You know, there are different organizations in Northern America and Europe. They really understood their clients, their users or their clients very well, their preferences. And then they have designed their products, or they have actually packaged or priced their products according to a user thing. Now, there is a new thing which is coming up in the market is called value-based proposition. When I say value-based proposition, I think most of you folks will be aware about the surge pricing these days. Most of the taxi providers like Uber, Ola, they do. So they do, in most of the metropolitan cities, they do surge pricing. Now, why, how the surge pricing is based on is based on the business analytics. So they do a business throughout the day from morning to evening. Now, what they realize is around certain areas, maybe around a factory, an industry, an IT park, there will be users who would be logging into or moving into these facilities at certain time, and they'll be moving out of these facilities around certain durations. Now, what you can do is you do a business throughout the day, and you know that your business will be more in demand in certain time phases, maybe during lunch hours, maybe morning logging times, evening logout times. So they do a business analytics on it. What is a business they would have got in these time slots? Based on that, they start doing a surge pricing. I know there are oppositions to it, but that's how the business is they are trying to conduct. So they know that around these time frames, their business is in demand. So they did a business analytics on those, and they start doing a surge pricing. Then you can start bidding for it. I think people who have used those services will know that 2 times, 3 times, 1.5 times of the price that you're paying. I know as an end user, you are at loss, but for a business, it is an advantage that, you know, you can do a value-based proposition of your business based on demand. Because there will be certain users who are willing to pay a premium price to get your business. I think this was in news in Indian on Indian Railways also. It's also trying to do a value-based proposition or for certain routes or certain trains that which can give it more price. So you can start bidding for it, and you'll get at a premium price. You'll be able to avail that service. So these are successful stories for a business. I mean, the business analytics, so where their businesses have really were able to find a way to get more revenues for their product or for their business. Now, if Uber or Ola, these organizations, if they would have continued doing it on a normal pricing and packaging, they would have not earned more. And now, since they have understood, they did some analytics on it, and they understood that, yes, you know, I can get more business in the areas or on these timelines, on these time floats. So they start, they have just changed their business model a little bit, and then they introduced the surge pricings. So it actually helps to, you know, be successful in business analytics if you really apply the business analytics. And you can see, I mean, you'll hear more such success stories in near future where organizations have really improved their business based on business analytics. But all this depends on the quality and quantity of the data that you're getting. So I'm sure when we talked about the search pricing, they would have got a sufficient data to say that on certain geographical locations and with certain number of users using that service or that business, they would have made a decision on it. So, and that should be a qualitative data. I mean, you cannot just assume a fake data or a data which is not actually aligning to your use case. Once you have such data, you also need the analyst who's skilled and understands the technology and the business very well, and who also has the statistical skills to derive insights out of it. And again, the very important thing is the organization which want to do this data-driven analytics. You know, if you still stuck to your own old legacy business rules or your approaches, I mean, there are organizations which are still little reluctant to move into this space. But there is a shift. So, an organization's willingness to get into this data-driven decision making is also very important. So let's take a very quick look on what are the different stages involved in business analytics. First thing is, you obviously have to derive a use case. Once you have a business use case, then you start getting building the data, and then find the patterns, take a sample data and try to do a statistics on it, and then predict. So we'll be looking at these stages very in detail here. Yeah, so first thing is, what is your analytical need? So as we said, we want to do a value-based proposition. We want to do a search pricing. We want to do anything. I mean, that is your business use case. So what is it? Or maybe you want to see what is your sales around certain time, or you want to improve your sales for those durations or for those topographies. So first thing is, obviously, an organization has to define a use case or a need for your business analytics. Then once you have identified it, you have to start actually acquiring or building the data. Now this data could be from your own business systems, or can be from different sources or data, places from where you get this. So if it's from your own system or maybe from your own warehouse, it need not go through a cleansing and processing phase. But if you are getting it from other sources, you may have to just remove a dirty data or an unwanted attributes in your data before you start processing it. Then once you have your processed and cleansed data available to it, you will try to find the patterns. You will describe the patterns and the association between each entities in your data. So this phase is where you spend more time, and because you are actually trying to get into an ocean, and you're trying to find a correlation which may exist and in certain rows, which may not exist in other rows. So this is where you spend more time. And it's also important to spend a comprehensive and a time on this phase, because, you know, unless you do this, you'll not be able to establish or understand your data very well. So once you have done this, that is where you actually get into the core of business analytics, where you start applying your statistical quantitative analysis on sample data sets. Again, it's not on the whole data set, because you're trying to train your algorithm, or you're trying to train your model on it. Now don't get too worried about models and statistics, because now you have different tools like R, and Excel also has a very comprehensive library on statistics. So all you need to do is you need to be a little familiar with those libraries and before you start applying. But internally, what you do is you will take a sample data set and start applying your model on it. And once you gain a confidence that your model is comprehensive, your model has gained all the necessary attributes, and it is giving you the accuracy of your model is improving. So once your model is accurate, you can start predicting the future results. So these are the three few important steps you will obviously, you will always see in any type of business analytics. Right, so we've been talking about analytics for quite some time now, but there are different types of analytics, again, based on your use case. So to be, let's talk from bottom to top. So the first type of analytics is descriptive. When I say descriptive, you're just describing something which has already happened in the past. So maybe let's say in our example, we said, what was my sales figure for Q3, Q4? So you will say that based on what something has happened, the historical data, you will say that these were my sales figure for Q3 and Q4. And then it is already fixed. I mean, you're not doing more than that. Now you may argue that what kind of analytics this would help in. This actually helps in deriving the key performance indicators or metrics for a business based on historical data. And all this is again written onto a real-time dashboard, or you can create some reports out of this. So diagnostic is again based on historical data. So you look at the past performance and then you say that what just happened. Maybe let's say your sales figure dipped to with on certain percentage. Then you'll try to find out why it dipped. Maybe certain reason could be is that you introduced a new feature in your product which people didn't like, and they just said no, I'll not buy this product. Or maybe you just spend more on certain ad campaign. So there are different attributes again. So it just helps you to tell in the past why it has happened. I mean, we just saw in descriptive, it tells you what were your sales figure. And then in the why part, we see in the diagnostic analytics, we see that why it dipped. Now the predictive analytics is where most of the organizations would be keen to getting into this type of analytics. Remember again, it's not that you always directly get into a predictive analytics. Most of the organizations, they spend a considerable duration of time on descriptive and diagnostic analytics. In fact, if you speak to any analytic consultant, they would they'll always suggest you to spend a handsome time on these two phases, because that's where you start building your knowledge or your understanding on your historical data. So once you are through to it, now you understand your data, you understand different data patterns in your historical data, you will be equipped to see and start predicting your database, predicting your future outcomes. Now you can predict what could be your future sales. You can predict as case of search pricing. We have seen that you can predict and say that, you know, around certain durations. Like, now one interesting aspect which I would like to say tell you is let's say you just predicted that, you know, around certain durations in case of, you know, commercial taxi vendors, we have seen that they predicted that around morning and around evening you see more business coming in. So you start actually allocating more resources, in this case more taxis around those regions, like, you know, factories or IT parks or any other regions, so where you see more business is capable. So you start aligning all your resources around, or maybe product resources around those areas. But let's say there was a public holiday on that day, and your algorithm didn't consider those days, and since your software is already designed to allocate more resources along those areas or on those topographies, it starts allocating. So this again, as I said, is predictive analytics. Now the model that we just designed will only help. It just saw my historical data and it just said, so maybe there was certain thing which is due to this, the company is not operating, or maybe the industry just shut down its business. So around that area, you don't see any more businesses. So your prediction can go wrong in those areas. So that's why if you start doing your prediction directly on a data set, on an available data set, you may fall flat. So you need to do a descriptive analytics on the existing data set before you actually derive your predictive analysis, or, you know, usually when you do a predictive forecasting. The prescriptive this is very often not been in usage. Not many organizations are doing prescriptive analytics, because it needs kind of building an artificial intelligence into your system. Now, you just said you predicted your future sales or your future business around certain topographies. Maybe there was a dip in your sales or business, how you could prevent that, how you can do a prevention of it. But to do a prevention, it needs lot of input variables. And these input variables can be constant and may not be constant, and they can keep changing. So prescriptive analytics is a very nascent stage of analytics, and not many organizations are doing, but it certainly gives an organization the capability of preventing something which from happening, an event from happening. So just to summarize, descriptive, it just tells you what just happened with your data. Diagnostic, it tells you from your past data why those events just occurred. Predictive, it helps you to tell what may happen in your future. You can start predicting. And prescriptive is how it can be prevented, and how you can prevent from certain event from occurring. Yeah, this part I want to keep it very minimum, because I know there are folks who are coming from different streams may not be really able to correlate with the technology stack. But at a high level, Apache Hadoop is one of the free open source systems which is built on. It's a platform that enables a lot of big data processing and tools. It gives you free open source tools, and there are distributions which are built around this Hadoop, Apache Hadoop. Which is again commercial, and which gives you an enterprise support. So to take a quick look on the Hadoop tech stack, if you want to divide this, so these are the four areas in which you will see the tech stack. First thing is obviously data ingestion. So there are tools that help you to ingest your big data or your data into the platform. If you go back to the previous slide, the tools that we are looking at is the scoops. Scoop is one important, very free open source tool which helps you to do data ingestion. And then you have data processing. Now this is where your actual business logic is applied. You want to write some business logic to process your data before. Maybe there are certain business rules you want to apply on data. This sometimes is more useful in descriptive analytics. I know you want to do on an ingested data, which is ingested in batches. You want to apply MapReduce is the underlying framework for processing or applying this business logic. So I'm sure most of us will not get into this phase. And then we have analysis. So yes, I mean we have different tools like Pig, Hive, Mahout. These are all the tools which are available on big data platform, which helps you to do a data analysis on the ingested data. So you can directly ingest using a scoop, you can ingest the data into the platform, into the cluster, and then you can start writing some pig scripts or some basic Hive queries. And Mahout is very famous in machine learning, so again on the statistics side. So these are the tools which are on the offering for doing an analysis. Storage, if you see the previous slide, the most of the storage is on the Hadoop distributed file system. So your data is actually broken into blocks, and it is distributed across different data nodes. So underlying framework takes care about it. We never worry about how the data is organized. But HDFS gives you certain tools to directly put your data and or retrieve the data. So there are certain tools available on the platform which you can use for storage and retrieval or reviewing your data. So this is very vast topic. Again, may be very subjective and may not be relevant for this whole discussion. So I just broke down into these categories, and more importantly, we'll be keen on seeing the analysis, the tools that are available that we just spoke about, Pig, Hive, and Mahout. And there are many tools. I mean, today Apache has been releasing free open source tools for data analysis in big numbers. So again, on the data processing, as I said, most of the times as a business analyst, you may not be very keen on doing data processing. There'll be big data engineers who will do this processing for you based on the business rule, or maybe you would write a business requirement for it as a business analyst that, I want to apply these set of rules on the ingested data, and you do it. So the big data engineer will take care about transforming those tools into a software and, you know, writing a piece of MapReduce program and then transforming it. So business rules, again, are very complex. It's only a business analyst who decides about those rules. So as a business analyst, again, you don't have to worry about writing a piece of code. You may just write those rules for your software development teams. So why Hadoop? I mean, this is popular framework, and it's been there for almost, I think, 2004 onwards. So it's close to 8 to 9, or it's reaching a decade, more than a decade. Now, this is very popular among it's been there in the market for a very long time. So these are the attributes. It's very reliable because the fault tolerance or the replication, there are the framework, underlying framework takes care about it. So you really don't have to worry that, you know, one of your nodes in your cluster, if it goes down, what will happen to your data? The same framework automatically pulls the data into another node and, you know, creates the replicas for it. So it's quite reliable. Why it's economical is because it's built. Today you can build a Hadoop cluster using commodity hardware. Maybe let's say we all folks can join our laptops and our devices to one name node, and we can become one cluster. So there's no need for us to get into a high-end database server or a server with more number of cores or enterprise server. So it's very economical, flexible, and scalable because it's very easy to grow your cluster very well, because you can keep adding nodes, you can decommission nodes, you can add just a, there is no rule that, you know, I have to just add a certain server and I shouldn't be able to add another desktop or another laptop as one of the nodes. So you can keep adding, you can start keep decommissioning, and everything will be transparent to the end user. You know, I mean, you will not see any downtime to it. So it's quite flexible and scalable. Right, so one of the very important questions we, as a business analyst or as a business analytical analytics profile, we have that, do we really require a programming skill? When Hadoop started, when people started building Hadoop, Apache Hadoop, most of the data processing, the MapReduce that we spoke about, there you actually write your, implement your business logic, was written in Java. Even today, the MapReduce framework itself has APIs which are written in Java, so you can consume those APIs. But you know what the community has realized, that just restricting it to Java wouldn't help, because if you want to have a wider acceptance, there would be people from different roles and responsibilities. Like, you know, there could be people from business analysts, there could be people from testing, there could be people from just who write requirements, like solution designers. So there could be different people who might be interested to utilize this framework. They started writing tools. Like, for instance, we have seen Hive in our previous slides. So Hive is built by Facebook, and Pig is built by Java, by Yahoo. And there are more tools coming in, as I said. So these tools, they abstract the MapReduce framework. So they also use a map. Keep in mind that whenever you're on the cluster, everything, all the processing goes through the MapReduce framework. But they just abstracted everything, and then they gave a tool. Like Hive is more like a SQL tool. So you can write SQL queries, and it transforms those SQL queries into a MapReduce job, and then you get the output of it. Similarly, Pig is more suitable for people from testing who have scripting understanding and you know, some basic scripting language jargon. So likewise, you really don't have to worry too much. Now, all these tools that have been built, they ensure that, you know, they don't require any programming skills. You really don't have to be you need to know any Java or C or any object-oriented or procedural languaging skills. So you can use these tools, and you can still get the data insights out of it. So, it may not be an absolute necessary for you to be very skilled in programming, but the key attribute or key skill that you need to acquire as a business analyst or as a business analytical guy is having a statistical awareness, because any sample data sets, whether it is processed or unprocessed, whether it's big data or non-big data, you should be aware about all these statistic analytical techniques, you know, like different distribution curves or different models like linear regressions or multilinear regressions. You will know once you subscribe to these courses, you'll be knowing that, you know, what the different techniques are there, different frameworks or statistical frameworks are there to analyze the data. So again, even there, you have tools like R, SAS, Python, you know, they have built-in libraries for these statistical algorithms. But awareness is always important, because, you know, you should be knowing that when you should apply those libraries, or when you should be using, for instance, linear regression. If you, most of the times we feel that it's just the numbers that we are dealing with, so I'll just go ahead and apply a linear regression algorithm, but it doesn't satisfy all the criteria. So it's actually that awareness is important. Where you should be using or applying those libraries is very important to know. So yes, programming is not important, but programming skills is not important, but it's important to know all the statistical part of it. Okay, the career options, there are many. You know, you have BA strategy consultants, there are business intelligence and performance management consultants, and then you have some roles also require an advanced analytics and optimizations. And at the enterprise level, you have information and management consultants, and then you also have content management consultants. So whatever role you are into it, the end goal is, again, based on what business use case you are driving in, and what type of statistical skills you have. So for an organization, irrespective whether you're in at an enterprise level or you're at a content management level or at a BA strategy level, all organization would look at two important things. They'll look, what is your business acumen? That means how well you understand your business. And maybe you can also derive a use case based on your acumen or your cognizance on the business. And second thing they would look at is how skilled you are on the statistical part of it. So how good you are at it. So don't worry too much about the big data, because there will be, as I said, big data engineers or data engineers who can help. And it's not expected for a business analytics to do a data processing, because it needs certain programming skills. But all you would require is first deriving a use case, a very important a business use case that can help a business to win a new client or to win a new market, or it can improve your current product profile. So business use case can also be, you know, at the process level, where you can do process assessment, and you can establish a new use case to establish a new process. So all business use cases can be varied, but they, as an organization, they would obviously look at your skill as a business analyst to see how good you can write a business use case. And then second would be, once you have written a use case, and once you are given with a data set, how well you can apply a statistics on it to derive a data pattern and reach at the predictive future outcome. So this is from one of the internet sources. There has been a constant demand and rise in need for business analysts and business analytics. You know, if you have seen the one of the reports says that there is a shortage of close to 1.4 to 1.9 lakh individuals or resources who has a deep understanding on business analyticals, and there could be more such openings coming up in the market, because there are more and more market organizations who are realizing the potential to make a decision based on the statistical or business analytical skills. So, you know, these are very promising days and for business analytics or analytics in general. It's just important that we should get equipped and ourselves to tap these market needs. So mostly popular roles which are in very quite good demand, which I've seen in a few of the organizations and with my experience, the business analytics with R. This R is an open source tool which has built-in libraries for statistical modeling and regression analysis. And even Excel, you guys would be surprised, has a very, very, very extensive and rich library on statistics. And it also gives you built-in data visualization. So business analytics with Excel and data visualization is also in demand, because most of the times you may be only dealing with sample data sets. You just put them into Excel and you add have this API of Excel, the add-on of the Excel that can, once you're familiar with the statistics, you can start using those Excel libraries with just one click of a button. And data analyst, this is even a little bigger role where you also, apart from business, you have more understanding on data, how a data is organized or produced. So you start creating dashboards out of this data, and maybe with a little business acumen, or you can still produce some KPIs out of it. So as a Techcanvass, we have been monitoring this constant demand in the market and how the organizations have been trying to build these skills. And so we want to cater to these this skill gap, and we're also trying to build some educational series on business analysis and business analytics. So Techcanvass will be launching the following courses around 1st October 2016, which will help you to gain some insights or learn some things on business analytics with R, business analytics with Excel, and then you have data visualization with R and data visualization with SAS. So SAS, we'll be starting a little later. SAS is a commercial tool, which you may, it's still advanced, but preferred, there are people which are more inclined towards R, because R is an open source, and it's also equally good in having a very rich library on statistics. So you guys can enroll with us, and you can obviously get an edge on tapping this growing need of business analysis and analytics. So there are very good use cases which are coming in the market. So what right now the business or the organizations are struggling is to find a skilled resource who can help, who can actually realize or transform these business use cases into predictive analytics. So I think that's all I had for this session. If you have any questions, you can go ahead and raise. I will be glad to answer any questions if anyone of you have.